Thank you for the nice introduction and for inviting me to give a lecture on relativistic hydrodynamics from kinetic theory. So this will be quite on a very basic level. Essentially, I would like to give the simple examples and present whatever towards the end I will present what I've done in deriving hydrodynamics from kinetic theory. So what is hydro? Essentially, it's the dynamics of a system which exhibits collective behavior. So it's a long wavelength, small low frequency limit of the microscopic dynamics of a system. And it finds application in cosmology, heavy ion collision, astrophysics, a lot of places. So heavy ion collisions, hydrodynamics have been quite successful in explaining a large number of phenomena. And the way it is formulated, the relativistic hydro in general, is in an order by order expansion in gradients, where ideal hydro is zeroth order. The relativistic Navier-Stokes is first order, which exhibits a causal behavior, and that's why we are prompted to go to second order theory, which is the Israel-Stewart theory, which is generally applied to heavy ion collisions. So I will quickly go through the basics of the formulation. So for a relativistic system, mass density is not a good degree of freedom. We have to account for the kinetic energy, and therefore energy density is what we consider as the degree of freedom for relativistic hydrodynamics. Similarly, 3 velocity should be replaced by the fluid 4 velocity. However, the number of degrees of freedom in the 3 velocity doesn't change. It remains 3 because of the fact that it is normalized to 1, time-like. And the hydrodynamic equations are essentially just the conservation equation of energy momentum and conserved currents. So T mu nu is the energy momentum tensor, and N mu is the charge current. And for ideal hydro, the way we obtain the energy momentum tensor is that we say that we have one vector and a tensor in the theory, and we can construct a two-rank tensor in the following way with the unknown coefficients, which we determine by going to the local restriction of the fluid. And these coefficients turns out to be what is well known in terms of energy density and pressure. And for simplification, we introduce a projection operator delta mu nu, which is constructed in such a way that it is orthogonal to the fluid velocity. And similarly, we can, in a similar way, we can also get the ideal conserved charge current. However, fluids are in general dissipative in nature, and one also needs to include dissipation. So here I show the comparison between ideal and dissipative hydrodynamics. For ideal hydro, we have energy density, pressure, and three independent components of u mu, amounting to, and of course the number density, so 6 independent variables. The conserved equations are 5, one conserved current, and 4 from that energy momentum tensor. And with equation of state, it's closed. However, dissipative hydro, we have the bulk viscosity, viscous pressure, the shear stress tensor, and the dissipative contribution to charge current. And that leads to 9 unknown equations, which has to be determined. And essentially, those are these dissipative quantities in red. Just a disclaimer that this form of energy momentum tensor and conserved current is written in the Landau frame. So it's hidden here, which does that. The fluid velocity is an eigenvector of the energy momentum tensor with energy density as the eigenvalue. So how do we determine the dissipative quantities? The bulk viscous pressure, the shear stress tensor, and the dissipative charge current. So essentially, one appeals to the second law of thermodynamics. In the most simplest form, it tells you that the entropy density, the local flow divergence, should always be increasing, should be positive. We appeal to the thermodynamics. So this is the first law of thermodynamics, well known. And then essentially, in differential form, we can write it like that. And demanding that energy is an extensive function of these variables, volume, the total entropy, and the number, total number, we can actually obtain an expression for the total energy in terms of pressure, volume, temperature, chemical potential, number, entropy. And in term, one can also represent it in terms of the densities, basically dividing by the volume. And then derive other relations. So I wanted to just quickly go through this, because this is what we'll need in the expression for entropy density. So for ideal hydro, entropy for current can be written as the flow of entropy density. And then the divergence, the fact that the entropy for current, the local divergence is always positive, once when we demand this, one can obtain the equations for the dissipative quantities. The bulk viscous pressure, the dissipative charge current, and shear stress tensor, up to first order in derivative of U and mu by T. Okay, the expressions are here in terms of the derivative. So theta is the local divergence of U mu. And then this quantity here is a symmetric divergence, symmetric derivative of U mu, which is space-like. And the transport coefficients, eta, which is shear viscosity, zeta is the bulk viscosity, lambda is the conductivity, they're all positive. And when we take the non-relativistic limit, these equations reduce to the Navier-Stokes equations. And this is all very beautiful and nice, but it's flawed because it exhibits a causal behavior. So essentially, so if you look at these equations, these constitutive relations, we can see that what it tells us is that, for example, as once we have, so once a gradient is generated in the fluid, it immediately is converted to a force. And this is basically the fact that leads to the causal behavior. So we can see that very easily. So what one does is one can perturb the system, so introduce a perturbation to energy density and fluid velocity, and then this perturbation, how it propagates along a direction, let's consider it y direction, which is the transverse direction to the perturbation. And then once we use the Navier-Stokes equation, what we get is a diffusion type equation. And this, one can use a Laplace Fourier wave ansatz to solve this diffusion, and they get the dispersion relation, which leads to group velocity d omega by dk, proportional to the wave number. And the wave, as we keep increasing the wave number, this velocity can exceed 1, which means that the system can have, so this disturbance that we created can propagate faster than speed of light inside the medium. And this is the causal behavior. So one way to rectify is that instead of this constitutive relation, which says that the gradient instantaneously converts to the force, we add a relaxation term, which gives a time scale in which this this gradient relaxes to the force, the shear force. And then the diffusion type equation becomes a relaxation type equation. And once we again repeat the exercise for the propagation of the disturbance inside the medium, we get the dispersion relation, which leads to a fluid velocity, which is bounded. So the maximum velocity that you can get is this expression here. And for all known fluids, it is limited. It's limited within 1. Okay. So then we can restore causality in the hydrodynamic theory by introducing a relaxation to the dissipative to the dissipative equation. Of course, a new time scale has entered into our theory. That is something we have to worry about. But even before that, one sees that this construction is done by hand, essentially introducing a relaxation kind of term. Okay, and one would like to get this from a more fundamental argument. So the way to do it is that we can construct, so this Maxwell-Catania version, we can construct it again from the entropy for current by introducing a correction to what we already had at the ideal level. So this in this simple example, I only consider the contribution from shear and ignore the other dissipative quantities. So up to second order, so with shear we can have contribution only up to second order. The first order contribution doesn't come into the picture. And then when we demand this local entropy divergence to be positive, we get this equation where the relaxation term comes automatically. So this is what we had, which restored causality. And these extra terms, it turns out, is fine and does not lead to any causality violation. So we have obtained a equation which is causal, and which we can use to introduce dissipation inside a system, relativistic system. And then there is this relaxation time which we saw could be related to the coefficient of that enters into the entropy flow current. Okay, so so the question then is that, is this the final form of that we can write for a shear stress tensor, or there is something more? So a general structure which can be which one is allowed to write, which are allowed by the symmetry for second order evolution equation. So this is the one which, so most generally we can actually, for a conformally symmetric system, we can write out all these terms. Okay, so the details are, one can just look it up here in this paper by Sayantan. And the coefficient of each terms are the transport coefficient which can be obtained from underlying microscopic theory of this system. Now these transport coefficients, like eta and even relaxation time, for some of them, one can write on the green correlations. So Alexey has been discussing them in more details. So for example, shear velocity can be written in terms of n. So this will be two-point correlation functions. So in this case, this is just the t mu correlation function at two different points. A general n-point correlators can also be evaluated for weakly coupled theory. And there has also been some progress for first-order transport coefficients in strongly coupled theories on lattice as well. So here are these two papers for shear and bulk viscosity by Harvey-Mayer. What we did essentially is that so we wrote down the entropy forecurrent. So we want to go back to the previous method of deriving hydro equations, dissipative equations. So we wrote down the entropy forecurrent in terms of the distribution function. Okay, and then if we this distribution function in terms of distribution function f. One has to, of course, know the form of f away from equilibrium. And this is what I will discuss after some time. But given that this distribution function away from equilibrium, if we demand the second law of thermodynamics from the entropy forecurrent, we can obtain the exactly this equation, what we have here, where all the transport coefficients now is known. Because we started from the form of f, there is no unknown in this. If we know f away from equilibrium, we can determine everything. So that's what we did, and we got some nice expressions for the relaxation times, which we checked in the case of. So it has some implications for ultra-relativistic heavy ion collisions as well. Okay, so we move on to relativistic kinetic theory. So I will quickly give a short introduction to that. So for a relativistic system, this is what we know for the energy density, energy which can be written as in terms of momentum and mass. And then we introduce the distribution function, which tells us that how many particles are there in the momentum range p and p plus delta p at a given point x inside the volume delta cube x. So this gives us the number of average number of particles in this phase space volume, small phase space volume. And of course, with the statistical assumption that the number of particles in this in delta cube x is large, however, this is small compared to the total volume of the system. So with that, one can calculate the number. So one can introduce the number density, the particle four particle flow, the current three current, and combine it in terms of particle four current, and obtain the expressions for the density and the current in terms of the distribution function f, where v is basically just the three velocity of the particles that we're considering inside the medium. So in a unified way, one can write down the current, the particle current, particle four current in terms of the distribution function. Similarly, one can write down the energy momentum tensor. So this is the energy density, energy flow, then momentum density and momentum flow. One can combine all that together into T mu in terms of the distribution function. Now, how do we obtain the distribution function away from equilibrium? So one of the methods that is very commonly used in kinetic theory is this grad's moment method, So the way it is done is that one considers the distribution function as f the equilibrium plus some deviation from equilibrium. And in terms of the deviation from equilibrium, one can write down the dissipative quantities in terms of this delta f in this fashion, which is with suitable projections, essentially. So these so projections of T mu nu, the scalar projection gives the bulk viscous pressure, the symmetric tensor projection gives the shear stress tensor, and a vector projection of particle four current on the space-like direction gives us the dissipative charge current. Okay, so now the starting point of grad's 14 moment approximation is that we start with this equilibrium form of the distribution function. And then we say that, okay, even if we go away from equilibrium, the form we assume to be the same, but only there is a correction to the to this equilibrium equilibrium form, and that is phi. This phi, which is the quantity which is the away from equilibrium contribution to the exponential, and that is expanded in powers of momentum essentially. So essentially this phi can be written as some scalar vector times p mu, a tensor times p mu p nu, and so on up to any order. Then we can put it in here in this expression for f and make a Taylor expansion. So what one gets is that delta f is proportional to phi, with where this f0 tilde is defined in this fashion. F0 is the equilibrium distribution function. Now, one can obtain these coefficients in the expansion by truncating the Taylor expansion up to some order. And in the 14 moment method, it is truncated up to second order in momentum. And once you truncate it up to second order in momentum and use some constraint relations, which one can obtain all these coefficients, essentially. Where all these A0, A1, these can be determined using these constraints of frame condition and matching conditions. So then this is, so the number of moments that, so essentially the number of unknowns and the order of truncation is enough to determine these quantities, these unknown quantities. The problem with this expansion is that why truncate at second order in momentum? Because there is no clear small expansion parameter in this model, the 14 moment method. So what I will demonstrate is a simple form that a simple way of obtaining this delta f. So close to equilibrium, where delta f is much less than 1, delta f by f0, and I will only consider shear stress tensor in this. So in this case, so that corresponds to low density fluid of massless particles. So for massless particles, bulk viscous pressure is 0, and there is no conserved current. So essentially, mu equal to 0. And start from the Boltzmann equation. So Boltzmann equation in the relaxation of in a very simple form of relaxation time approximation, which Alex discussed earlier. So we consider this, and then what one can do is one can do iterative Chapman and Skok like expansion, and get delta f up to any order you want in terms of the in terms of powers of gradients of f0. And then using this delta f up to, so if I use this delta f up to first order into this expression here, I get back the Navier-Stokes equation. Delta f1 plus delta f2 gives me the second order evolution equation for shear stress tensor. So this is the interesting part is for a conformal system, if I start from, if I use this expression for delta f from here, from the Chapman and Skok-like iterative expansion of Boltzmann equation, as well as from the grad's 14 moment method, the equation that I get for shear stress tensor remains exactly the same. So that is something which is quite baffling, because I still don't understand why that happens. But it differs when the system is non-conformal. So the coefficients change. But for a conformal system, when mass is zero, we get exactly the same expression. So one can play this game and go ahead in delta f1 plus delta f2, and one can calculate the second order corrections to the distribution function. And if so, here I just show how the how formally these two expressions are different. So the grad's floating moment method is given by this delta F1g that is only obtained up to first order. So you can see that although this part remains the same, the one of the temperature here, so essentially this goes linear in p in momentum because there is a u dot p sitting in the denominator, whereas these are the quadratic form in the momentum. And of course there are checks one has to do for the delta f, so it has to give us pi mu nu, then it has to satisfy the matching condition which tells us that the equilibrium energy density is the same as when you, so you construct your fictitious equilibrium for dissipative hydro such that the energy density matches with the equilibrium energy density. And then the Landau frame definition which says that the fluid velocity is eigenvector energy momentum tensor with eigenvalue energy density. And we found that this delta F that we obtain up to second order is satisfies all these conditions. And then we use that to to study some phenomenology essentially of heavy ion collisions. So this is just corrections to the spectra, which was that there is small corrections from Chapman and Scott, whereas grad leads to larger correction. What is interesting is this behavior of the longitudinal HBT radii. So the longitudinal HBT radii, the prediction, there was a prediction for ideal hydro which says that it should scale as 1 by root mt, the transverse mass of the correlated ions essentially. And also it was experimentally measured in NA69, I think, that they found that this 1 by root mt scaling was obeyed in the data. While grad's approximation violates that scaling relation, we have from the Chapman and Scott, it seems that the iterative Chapman and Scott respects this 1 by root mt scaling of the longitudinal HBT radii. So one can go ahead and calculate the third order equation for shear stress tensor. And this is what we get, total 14 new terms up in third order. It looks quite complicated, but in all fairness, this is not the longest expression you are seeing at up to third order in this school. So there is improved accuracy compared to second order, of course. But so that I will show that why I say that there is improved accuracy compared to second order. Why it is necessary is to incorporate colored noise in fluctuating hydro evolution. So this is what Kapusta and Young found, that if one wants to incorporate colored noise in a fluctuating hydro evolution, one has to go up to third order in hydro to be able to do that. And then if I start counting the number of transport coefficients, there was an analysis recently by Grozdanov and Kaplis, where they found that 15 new terms are new coefficients essentially, or 15 new third order terms are predicted from conformal symmetry. We obtained 14 new transport coefficient from kinetic theory. The one that is missed is this triple vorticity term. But of course, we know that even at second order, double vorticity term is missed. So that is not a surprise. And then, so in that sense, the third order equation that we obtained is complete. Now, regarding the transport coefficients, what one can do is one can make a gradient expansion. So how one does that is given here in this paper. So one can take the RTA Boltzmann equation and make an expansion, gradient expansion. So if I use the relaxation time approximation Boltzmann equation, and I do a hydro, and I coarse grain the Boltzmann equation to obtain hydro, then at each order, so if I, for example, the ideal hydro should match up to the zeroth order, the coefficients in, and similarly for the Navier-Stokes, the Isherhard-Stewart, and the third order. So it turns out that the third order hydro that we derived, the coefficients indeed match. But of course, one has to be careful because this is all done in Bjorken. So not all terms from here contribute into the Bjorken evolution. So that's, but still, whatever the terms contribute to the Bjorken expansion, Bjorken evolution, those have correct coefficients, at least that we can claim. So then we come to the Bjorkian flow. What exactly is Bjorkian flow? This also has been discussed in this school. I will quickly go through it. So in Milne coordinates, coordinate system tau and eta, one can, so the metric looks like here, where this is the non-trivial part. So even if the velocity, even if we take, so in the Milne coordinate system for Bjorkian expansion, the u mu looks like a rest frame, essentially 1, 0, 0, 0. However, the derivative of u mu would still be non-zero because of the non-vanishing Christoffel, or because of this non-trivial minus tau square in the metric. So essentially, one can use that, and the fact that Bjorkian expansion means that the z component of velocity scales like z over tau, and the eta, so u eta is zero, and u tau is in this form. So then one can write down the expression for evolution of pi eta component of pi. This is what we get for up to third order. PL by PT is then given, this is the pressure anisotropy, which should be iso. The point is that we call it pressure anisotropy, but if it is one, it is isotropic. So this is something like pressure isotropic measure. So if we go to equilibrium, pi goes to zero, so then PL by PT becomes one. Right, so then one can actually solve the Boltzmann equation numerically in relaxation time approximation and compare the results with second and third order, and this is what we find, that the third order hydro does better compared to the second order. That's what I meant by improved accuracy of third order over second order. The next example that I would show is when we have massive particles, but still there are no conserved currents in the system. So for massive particles, the bulk viscosity is non-zero. One can obtain the second order hydro equations for bulk viscous pressure and shear stress tensor. And the highlight is that within the relaxation time approximation, there is only one time scale for relaxation for both these dissipative current, dissipative quantities, bulk and shear. And that is the relaxation time of the Boltzmann equation. So in the ratios, they cancel. And what we get is a purely thermodynamic feature. So this bulk ratio of the bulk viscosity and shear viscosity scales like 1/3 minus C square, the whole square. This is the conformality measure, the square of the conformality measure. So what is this lambda? So that is when we make a small mass expansion around conformal theory. So in kinetic theory, conformality means putting mass equal to zero. And then what we see is that this scaling coefficient that we get here differs for what distribution function we use. For Bose-Einstein, so Maxwell-Boltzmann, for Dirac, there are these numbers you get. For Bose-Einstein, this scaling is not 2. It is 3 by 2. That's why the coefficient doesn't, we get some infinities for the coefficient. And this is very similar to, this scaling is very similar to what Weinberg found for a system of radiation interacting with matter. And then one can again compare these evolutions with the exact Boltzmann equation, the 14 moment and the iterative Chapman-Enskog that we proposed. And even for bulk, for non-conformal systems, we see that iterative Chapman-Enskog seems to do better than the 14 moment method for delta F. Then another example that I would like to show is when the mass is zero, but we repeat the whole exercise for non-zero chemical potential. In that case, again, one can obtain the second order. So it's conformal system, but there are charges in the system, conserved charges. So one can repeat the exercise, and we get the second order hydro equations for both of them. But there is an interesting ratio again. In this case, the ratio of heat conductivity over shear viscosity. And that one can calculate. So again, in this ratio, the relaxation time will drop out. and whatever is left is purely thermodynamic in nature. And what we see is that in the limit of small as well as large, very large chemical potential over temperature, these ratios, we get a scaling of this form. So T over mu square, that's the scaling we get with some coefficient. So these coefficients are these peculiar numbers here, and but they are the they're of the same order that one calculates from ADS-CFT calculations with R charge on a black hole, which is done by CERN and study nets. So, and what we understood is that this feature is purely because of the conformal, because we are dealing with a conformal theory, and has so nothing to do with a strongly coupled, because kinetic theory is weakly coupled, RTA. Well, of course, for RTA, one cannot say whether it's strongly coupled or weakly coupled, but kinetic theory by construction with is applicable for weakly coupled theories. So the reason of this scaling is one can attribute it only to the fact that the system that we are dealing with is conformal. So this is what I was talking about. So essentially in, so this 8 by 9 is the ADS-CFT calculation, and then the ratio 95 by whatever we have, it saturates to these constant numbers here in small mu by T as well as very large mu by T. The non-trivial variation is for the intermediate mu by T region. So I will quickly flash some recent interesting developments that we have been working on in kinetic theory and hydro, so that relativistic hydro with spin. So essentially, if we have system of particles with intrinsic spin, we should also worry about the angular momentum conservation, because if there are no spin in the system, then it's just this three index orbital part, which is conserved for symmetric energy momentum tensor. But if we have spin, then we have to worry about separately conserving the spin current as well. So basically, this is the three index total angular momentum tensor that we have. And so what one does is one can write down again, but this time we have to be careful about the distribution function. So the conserved current, the energy momentum tensor, and the spin current, or rather, so this is the spin part. So the spin current we can write down in terms of the distribution, the Wigner functions that in terms of. So this is our usual mu by T. So this part is well known. This is the one which we attribute to the spin in the system. And and we did use, and then we essentially, at the ideal level, we use the fact that entropy should be conserved, even for, because there is no interactions between orbital angular momentum and the spin part of the angular momentum. And what we found is that from a thermodynamic point of view, such a system of spin half particles can be seen as a two-component mixture of scalar particles. So if I just look at the densities and its dependence on the temperature, so it just behaves like two-component system of scalar particles rather than a single-component spin half particles. And then the other interesting thing that we recently started working on is if you consider an anisotropic metric. So if we want to do our kinetic theory in an anisotropic background, so and then we solve the Boltzmann equation, the free streaming Boltzmann equation for this Bianchi type 1 metric, then we get some solutions which tells us that that the energy momentum tensor that we construct is very similar to a hydro, the framework of a hydro. This a hydro framework has been used very very frequently by, in heavy and collision community. So essentially, it tells us that in terms of this anisotropic parameter, one can write down the energy density, the transverse, and the longitudinal pressure with some functions that has been introduced here. But this example, this we show only for the axis symmetric case. One can have a more general one, but the expressions are not in closed form like here. So essentially, so the point is, if we do our kinetic theory in an anisotropic background metric, we even for a free streaming particle, we get the hydrodynamic, anisotropic hydrodynamic framework. Then we saw that if we restrict the Bianchi type 1 metric to be the solution of Einstein equation in vacuum, then that's Kasner metric. And we get two cases. The first one is the longitudinal Bjorken expansion. From here, we get two different cases, the longitudinal Bjorken expansion, and a new solution which tells us that there is a transverse expansion and a longitudinal contraction. So that was what we found very interesting, and we believe it's relevant for this Horava-Lipschitz hydrodynamics, this class of Horava-Lipschitz field theories, they have this anisotropic scaling feature. So that's what we're planning to work on in the future. So the summary. So we have QGP is a phase of QCD, and we try to apply relativistic hydrodynamics to study its evolution. So first order Navier-Stokes leads to violation of causality, which we saw can be cured in a second order Israel-Stewart theory. One can do the second order, so we can derive in several ways, from entropy considerations, from kinetic theory. So I showed a derivation of third order hydro equation as well. And then we saw some interesting scaling results for the ratios of dissipative quantities. Thank you. I thank my collaborators for a nice collaboration.
Thanks, Amaresh, for this comprehensive talk and questions.
So you have defined that Xi parameter, anisotropy parameter as C square by A square. So is that a conventional definition for anisotropic parameter?
So essentially, sorry. I'll just, okay. So essentially the distribution function that you will get will be something like root over x square. So this is what we get for the solution of this Boltzmann equation in this background, this metric, essentially, this space-time, where xi is what you see here. And this is just the characteristic solution. So this tells us that the functional form should look like this. We can choose to put, so here, essentially, we just choose to put the, so this is this, so we can choose two of the x to be this, to have the same weightage, we choose the anisotropy to lie along z. So this is the form that essentially that's what the ahydro people work with. So that's what essentially I think answers that.
Has there been studies in kinetic theory including this chiral, vertical, and effect also?
So yeah, there has been in kinetic theory. So what one does is, of course, now that deals with the Boltzmann equation and putting this effective field, mean field, because of the chiral magnetic field, essentially, that's what, is that what you're asking? That
this new transport coefficient led to this, that the electric current, for example, can depend on the vorticity of the fluid.
So
it's a new transport, anomalous transport coefficient that.
So there has been, I have not yet started working on those topics, but there has been a lot of work in that direction by Karjev and many other groups. I'm not really much familiar with those.
Any further questions? If not, then let's thank Amaresh again and we break for the day.